And I welcome you all the fourth semester students of mine, to this seventh class lecture of mine. So I was discussing about in the previous lecture about the distinction between utopia and dystopia, and there I was compelled to stop this entire recording because of the natural interruption of thunder and rain. And due to that, I have to stop the previous video lecture. This is rather the last video lecture on Jonathan Swift's Gulliver's Travels. I was discussed about a kind of distinction between utopia and dystopia. Now, what is utopia? Utopia is an ideal society. Free society, free from poverty, disease, conflict, and unhappiness. Almost a perfect place. Used first by Thomas More in the 16th century. This means an ideal place. More was a Renaissance thinker. Almost a socialist state where everybody is equal. It originated from the Greek word which means oot. It means good, and topos means place. So, well place. It's a pun for nowhere. Nowhere means an imaginary place which doesn't exist anywhere in the world. While on the other hand, dystopia, the word dystopia actually signifies ill or bad one. So ill, this means ill or bad. So it means an abnormal place, a bad place. I have already shown you the pictures, the two portraits. One is a green tree, which is a manifestation of a good society. Greenery is suggestive of the fertility, not the barrenness. While this is a picture of almost a post-apocalyptic horror, it suggests a certain atomic explosion, which is destroying everything. So that's an example of the dystopia. So there lies the difference between utopia and dystopia. We can clearly say that in Gulliver's Travels, the utopia is that of the book 2, the land of the Brobdingnagians, while dystopia is the Lilliputian kingdom, where everything is unequal, the laws are very stringent because of that unequal land, where everything is hierarchical, where the laws are very discriminatory. On the other hand, utopia is an imaginary place where people lead dehumanized and often fearful lives. So, this dystopia is an example of the Lilliputian land. So, on the other hand, it contrasts to the utopia, which can be translated as good place. Dystopia can be translated as bad place. So, let us now begin about the philosophical and theoretical background of the Gulliver's Travels. Now, within the broad scheme of Gulliver's Travels, Gulliver seems to be an average man of the 18th century England. He is concerned with family, with his job, and yet he is confronted by the pygmies that politics and political theorizing make people. So, political theorizing make Gulliver, according to Swift, all these political personalities are mere pygmies. And Gulliver is the only giant in the land of the pygmies. He is a middle class, a British middle class personality. So Gulliver is utterly incapable of the stupidity of the Lilliputian politicians, and therefore he and the Lilliputians are ever present contrasts for us. We are always aware of the difference between the imperfect moral life of Gulliver and the petty and stupid political life of the emperors, the prime ministers, and the informers. So in the second book of the Travels, Swift reverses this size relationship he used in the book 1. In Lilliputian kingdom, Gulliver was a giant. In Brobdingnagian kingdom, Gulliver is a midgate, a small man. Swift uses this difference to express a difference in morality. So there lies the difference in terms of morality that you should understand. So, Swift at the same time praises the Brobdingnagians, but he does not intend for us to think that they are perfect humans. So, Brobdingnagians, they are not perfect humans. Their virtues are not impossible for us to attain, but because it takes so much maturing to reach the stature of a moral giant, few humans could achieve it. That's the expression, that's the personal statement of Gulliver himself. So Brobdingnag, as I've already stated, it's a practical moral utopia. Among the Brobdingnagians, there is goodwill and come virtue. So they are physically ugly when magnified, but they are morally beautiful. So you cannot reject them because Gulliver describes them as physically gross. If we reject them, we become even more conscious of an ordinary person's verminous morality. Gulliver's Travels is structured very much like a variation on the question, why are people so often vicious and cruel? This is a recurrent question that occurs throughout Gulliver's Travels, that why are people so often vicious and cruel? Why are people so cruel? Keno eto people eto cruel hoy? An answer, because they succumb to the worst elements in themselves. Tara nijeder je dosh, nijeder je worst element. Element is, according to the medieval physiology, element is a humor, is a liquid fluid that is present in the human. Greed and other personalities are part of our elements. So man is an infinitely complex animal, and he is many, many mixtures of intellect and reason, charity and emotion. But at the same time, they are also greedy. They are often also vicious. So in his time, it was a popular notion that a reasonable man was a complete man in Swift's time. And here Swift shows us reason exalted. We must judge whether it is possible or desirable for man. So ei je idea je man is a cruel personality is generally greedy, complete notion of human being, essentially manushke complete notion of man mane that personality who is not greedy. So in fact, even before he wrote Travels, Swift opposed excessive pride in reason in his ironical argument against abolishing Christianity. In his famous book, he makes it clear what he considers to be the consequences of depending on reason rather than upon faith and revelation. So reason er ki ki karon eta uni porishkari boleche. So to Swift, rationalism leads to deism, and deism, that is bhagavan ke pujo kora, deity ke pujo kora, deism leads to atheism, and atheism to immorality. So where people worship reason, they abandon tradition and the common sense. That's the basic idea propounded by Jonathan Swift. This is a picture where I try to show you the visualization in the Lilliputian kingdom. This is rope dancing. On the left, on the right, you can see rope dancing, and this is the display of the power. In one day, the emperor ordered that I stand like a statue, my legs as far apart as possible, while his troops marched under me with drums beating, colors flying, and pikes advanced. Gulliver almost stands there almost as a symbol, symbol of power, symbol of controlling authority, symbol of being a monster, the Basdiye, Lilliputian emperor, Lilliputian soldier, Gallo, Yuddhokotte, Blefuscudian Deshami. Gulliver ke dekhe, monobol na toda dhangsho hoye gelo Blefuscudian der je, Yuddhoi korte valo. On the other hand, this is an example of the rope dancing. In chapter 3 of book 1, Swift describes some of the activities of the imperial court. The activities including rope dancing and leaping over or creeping under sticks are obviously a satire on the way in which political offices were distributed among the candidates by the English king. Then I will, of course, I've already discussed about Gulliver's Travels as a political satire. Gulliver's Travels was unique in its day. It was not written to woo or entertain. It was an indictment. It was the most popular among those who were indicted. That is, politicians, scientists, in the book 3 of Gulliver's Travels, which you will not read, philosophers, and Englishmen in general. So it's a venomous satire. It's an indictment of the Englishmen in general. Swift himself says that he wrote this satire to vex the world, to confuse the world. This is the picture of Philnap, the treasurer, the treasurer in the land of the Lilliput. He is Sir Robert Walpole, who was the Prime Minister of England from 1715 to 1717, and then again from 1721 to 1742. Dancing on the tightrope, he symbolizes. Hello everyone, as I was continuing, I'm talking about a film map. The treasurer of the Lilliputian Empire is perhaps Sir Robert Walpole, who was the Prime Minister of England from 1715 to 1717, and then again from 1721 to 1742. So you will gradually understand that it's the book one is basically a satire against the contemporary British Empire, the contemporary British politics. So especially the dancing on a tightrope, it symbolizes Walpole's skill in parliamentary tactics and political intrigue. So jodi porikkhay proshno kore who is film map, you have to answer that film map is the treasurer of the Lilliputian Empire, perhaps representing Sir Robert Walpole. Continuing, similarly, another figure in the Lilliputian Empire, Rail Russell, perhaps represents Lord Carteret, who was appointed by Walpole to the office of Lord Lieutenant of Ireland. The phrase especially of one of the king's cushions refers to one of the King George's mistress, who played a vital role in bringing Walpole into the king's favor after his fall in 1717. The building where Gulliver stayed during his stay in Lilliput is perhaps the Westminster Hall, where Charles I was executed. So all these are topical, contemporary, political allusions. As I have said, that film map was perhaps Sir Robert Walpole. Rail Russell represents Lord Carteret. In the same way, one of the king's cushions, king er kubi kacher manush, prefer korche George the First, shei shomoye tar jodi mistress chilo take, ebong tar shonge shonge je building e ekta temple, desacralized temple, completely abandoned temple, এটা সাজেস্ট করছে রেস্টোরেশন ইংল্যান্ডে চার্লস দ্য ফার্স্টকে অলিভার ক্রমওয়েল যখন বিহেড করেছিল, মাথা কেটে নিয়েছিল, সেই সময়ে সেই সময়কার ওই পার্টিকুলার জায়গাটাকে, একটা একটা পার্টিকুলার অ্যাবান্ডন টেম্পলকে সাজেস্ট করছে গালিভারকে যেখানে থেকেছিল সেই সময়টা। অতএব এখানে একটা কন্টিনিউয়াস পলিটিক্যাল অ্যালিউশনস এই পার্টিকুলার বইতে কাজ করছে। পরীক্ষায় যে প্রশ্নটা পড়বার খুবই সম্ভাবনা, খুবই পড়ে, সেটা হচ্ছে গালিভার্স ট্রাভেলস অ্যাজ আ পলিটিক্যাল স্যাটায়ার। সো হোয়াট ইজ স্যাটায়ার? ইউ ডু নো দ্যাট স্যাটায়ার ইজ আ পার্টিকুলার ওয়ে অফ আ কাইন্ড অফ ভার্স, ইট ক্যান বি আ ভার্স অর ইট ক্যান বি ফিকশন, আ পার্টিকুলার ওয়ে অফ অ্যাটাকিং দ্য কন্টেম্পোরারি সোসাইটি থ্রু লেম্পুন অর থ্রু এনি আদার ফর্মস অফ অ্যাটাকিং ডিভাইস। সো how Gulliver's Travels is a political satire? Because various allusions, various political allusions, various scathing forms of attack is very much present in Gulliver's Travels. For example, the search of Gulliver's body by the Lilliputians, maybe the satiric representation of the committee set up by the Whigs to investigate the conduct of the previous government, and especially of the Oxford and Bolingbroke, who were suspected of the treasonable relationship with France and the old pretender. So this relationship of the Oxford and the Bolingbroke actually refers to the treasonable relationship between France and the old pretender who has a relationship with France. So on the occasion of George the First in 1714, the Whigs come to power, and a committee was formed in 1715. Swift here seems to satirizing the activities of the Whig committee. Gulliver's dead body search, jokon khuje berachhe era, ei je search of the Gulliver's body, this suggests perhaps to a committee formed by the Whigs in 1715. A particular committee take satirize korar jonno chesta korchen ekhane amader Jonathan Swift. In a similar way, Skyresh Bolgodam, another very important character in this particular narrative, has been identified as the Earl of Nottingham, and Swift satirizes him because he withdrew his support from the Harley government. So these are the various political allusions that are embedded inside the text of the Gulliver's Travels. In the same way, the egg breaking episode, the question of breaking egg, in which end they will break, the controversy regarding the egg breaking episode that occurs in Gulliver's Travels, it actually refers to between the big Indians and the little Indians. It actually refers to the long standing enmity between England and France. France ebong England er moddhe je dirgho diner boirita ebong shatruta somporko take refer korche. Politically, Lilliput stands for England and Blefuscu stands for France. England was a country of Protestants and France was a Catholic country. Naturally, the two countries were at the daggers drawn, and the Lilliputians knew Blefuscu to be the only country in the universe. So, England ebong France er moddhe je boirita somporko ekta Protestant England ar Catholic France er moddhe seta ekhane allude kora hoyeche. And the reference to the grandfather of the present emperor who cut his finger breaking an egg, perhaps been alluded to Henry VIII. Henry broke with Rome over the question of the papal authority and also over the matter of Annie Bolian. So basically, Gulliver's Travels, as I've said, it's an allegorical satire. Why allegory? Because it alludes to various forms of stories. At the same time, it tries to build various symbols. And hence, it's an allegorical satire. And in it, Swift presents the picture of the current political situations in a most satirical way. The concluding book, he gives us a hopeless picture of the mankind. But in the first two books, the satire is more genial and comic. So, through this, I am ending Gulliver's Travels. Ami already tomaderke tale bollam Gulliver's Travel as a very important text of political satire. I've discussed the conflict between the Whigs and the Tories. I've discussed you about how Jonathan Swift's Gulliver's Travel is an anti-Whig satire. At the same time, I've discussed chapter-based analysis of Gulliver's Travels, and I've also critically commented on every chapter of Gulliver's Travels. Now, I will talk about certain important questions, the questions that can be asked in the fourth semester examinations. What are they? Ki proshno aste pare? Ek number, Gulliver's Travels as a political satire or as a satire. Clear? Bar bar bolechi keno it's a rajnoitik bidrupattok rochona keno bolechi why it's a political satire seta ei allusion gulo prottekta Gulliver's Travels gulo royeche likhte hobe. Gulliver's Travels as a children's fiction. Many critics described Gulliver's Travels as a children's fiction. Why? Because generally the imagery of the Lilliputs, the Brobdingnagians, the big people, the giant, it will attract to the child's imagination, and hence it's a children's fiction. But beyond the layer of the children's fiction lies a scathing and virulent satire on the contemporary 17th century England, 16th century England. So you have to elaborate on this. You have to also can talk about political satire in the answers to the children's fiction, that why it's not a children's fiction. And you have to also give logic that why it's a children's fiction. To substantiate this into introduction, that what is a children's fiction? Character of Captain Lemuel Gulliver, important question. And Gulliver as an unreliable narrator. Why is not a reliable narrator? And you have, can be also asked as a Gulliver suppose as a imperialist and colonialist or post-colonialist text. Various allusions to the empire, the operation of the power, the relations of the power between the emperor and Gulliver, the relationship of the between the emperor and the subject, duto empire in the empire of the Lilliput and in the empire of the Brobdingnagians. Ebong kemon kore ei duto empire rajar je position, rajar je location, raja kemon kore tader subject der prokader ke shashon korche, tar je difference chokhe porche setao likhte hobe. Important question aste pare Swift's prose style, in which language Swift is constructing his entire narrative. And very important question, Swift as a misanthrope can be asked as a hater of the human being, shopki reject question. And finally, elements of utopia in Gulliver's Travels, the element of it, not lemons, sorry for the spelling mistake. elements of utopia in Gulliver's travels. What is used to utopia? What's the basic difference between utopia and dystopia? I have already discussed that utopia is an ideal kingdom, at adorsho, rashtro utopia, where everybody is equal. It's a socialist standpoint rather. And what is the difference with dystopia? And how Gulliver's Travels Book 2 is especially an utopia. So these are some of the questions that can be asked. Various 5 marks question can also be asked. তোমরা একটু ভিডিওটাকে পজ করে দেখে নেবে, তো আমি বলে দিচ্ছি, এছাড়াও আমি পাওয়ার পয়েন্টে তোমাদের সঙ্গে শেয়ার করে দেবো। হোয়াট ইজ দ্য সিম্বলিক সিগনিফিকেন্স অফ লিলিপুট, হু আর দ্য লিলিপুটস, দে আর বেসিক্যালি লিটল পিপল, বাট হোয়াই দে আর লিটল, কেন তাদেরকে ছোটো করে রিপ্রেজেন্ট করা হচ্ছে, তার কি তাদের সাইকোলজিক্যালি বা মাইন্ডের দিক থেকে তারা লিটল, হোয়াই দে আর লিটল, হাউ ডু দ্য লিলিপুটিয়ান্স ট্রিট গালিভার ওয়েন দে ফার্স্ট এনকাউন্টার হিম, what is the great service performed by Gulliver to the emperor of Lilliput and what is this reward, why is Gulliver so eager to assert his own country's importance to the Brobdingnagians, why he is very much eager to assert his own country's importance, keno England er gurutto dekhabar chesta korche Brobdingnagian er kache, who is Skyrish Borgoland, who are the Blefishcurians, why does Gulliver keep travelling despite his many misfortunes, eto kichu boro keno continue korche, what are the two empires fighting about in Gulliver's travels, what are the two empires fighting about in Gulliver's travels, and what is the significance of size in Gulliver's travels, key significance size, and who is Gulliver, who are the Lilliput, ami agi bolechi who are the Lilliputians, symbolic significance, and how did Gulliver help the king of Lilliput in various ways. So these are the various questions that can be asked. Thank you for your kind patience. This is a long lecture. I have completed almost 7 lectures in Gulliver's Travels, I think, yes. So see you in the next lecture. In the next class, perhaps I will talk about Jane Eyre, 4th semester, Jane Eyre. Okay. Charlotte Bronte's Jane Eyre, a Victorian text. Till then, thank you. Bye. Sayonara.